Good morning, everyone. If we could, let's all please stand and either turn to the screen or turn to hymn 205. And we're going to sing two times. Hymn 205, Jesus is the sweetest name I know.
Lord, we just come to you this morning and just thank you for just a good morning this morning, Lord, to come out and worship you. We just pray for the people in our community that are sick, Lord, and are still healing from this virus, Lord. We just pray that you just lift them up, touch them in a special and mighty way, Lord. I know we've had people in our community that have lost loved ones over these last couple months, Lord. They are in discomfort this morning, Lord. Just be with them and just lift them up in a special way this morning, and just give them your guiding hand as they go about their lives, Lord. We just pray that this week, as we go about doing your business, Lord, that we just put our eyes on you, and just be with us now during this worship service. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Just a couple of announcements, and we'll continue on with our worship. We praying for our pastor. He's taking a little break down south, a well-needed and deserved break. So I'm sure he's watching today. So we're glad that he made it down there safe and sound yesterday, and hope he recharges his batteries a little bit, and we can enjoy this worship service together this morning. A couple of announcements. We've got the Jolly Jays that's going to be meeting, and that's going to be Thursday, February the 11th at 10:30 a.m. There's going to be a speaker, and there'll be lunch that'll be provided. So be here for that, all you Jolly Jays. We have next Sunday, we have two important things going on. We've got our business meeting, which will be done right after our church service. So looking forward to that. And we'll also, at 8 in the morning next Sunday, we have our deacons meeting that we always have during the month. And then following that, immediately by 8:45, the deacons are going to be meeting with the buildings and grounds for a little bit. So we're looking forward to that as well. So that'll be all that will be next Sunday. So we're excited to talk about a few things with that. We also have VBS that we're planning on that's coming up that we're going to be planning pretty soon. If you would like to be a part of VBS, let us know that. The more the merrier. We have so many people that help us out with Awanas. And usually we have that same group that tries to help out with VBS. But if you're not involved in Awanas, you'd like to be involved in VBS this summer, we'd love to have you be a part of that. So just let us know that, and we'll find something good for you to do to help us out with VBS. So that'll be coming up soon. Is there any other announcements this morning? Got any visitors this morning? Okay. Nice to have y'all this morning. And looking forward to y'all coming every week. Good to see y'all. We're going to continue on now. Ben's going to lead us in some music. And then hopefully y'all stick around and not leave when I start preaching. Yes. Okay. I did not know that. Okay. Why don't I just lead us in a prayer for the Hatchell family, if that's okay. Lord, we just come to you this morning. We just lift up the Hatchells, Lord, as they're suffering from this loss. Lord, we just pray that you just lift them up during this tough time, Lord, and just be with them in a special and a mighty way, this morning. Just give them comfort during this difficult time. That's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, Ben.
Difficult, all please stand and turn to hymn 579. And we're going to sing the first and last verse of hymn 579. Shine, Jesus, shine.
Oh, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth which are bringing us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine.
Sing the first and last verse of hymn 206, Blessed Be the Name. Sing the first and last verse of hymn 204, Glorious is Thy Name.
Blessed Savior, we adore Thee, we Thy love and grace proclaim. Thou art mighty, Thou art holy, glorious is Thy matchless name. Glorious, glorious.
special music from Miss Holly.
Actually, I did not decide what I was going to sing until probably about 15 minutes ago. I had some ideas, but after our Sunday school lesson this morning and then talking to Jorey about what he was preaching on and the fact that Valentine's Day is coming up, I thought what better time to sing about the love of God than now. This morning, our verse in Sunday school was, when Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all flesh to give eternal life to all whom you have given him, and this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. And, you know, what more uplifting verse than that, to know that God had such a love that he would go to the cross for us. Sometimes I used to think when I was growing up, we talked about this a little bit in Sunday school this morning, that everything you did, you're going to go to hell for. I mean, if you slipped up and done, told a lot, white lie or whatever, you were doomed for hell. And, you know, it's not like that. The fact that God loves us so much that he went to the cross for us, the fact that he did something nobody would ever do for us. And then I heard something one time that said, no matter what we do or what we don't do, when Christ went to the cross, that's all it took for him to love. He couldn't love us ever any more or any less than that time. So just listen to the words of these songs. This song, I'm sure you've heard it. Now, it's a little bit low, so just bear with me.
I owe all to you. I
Thanks, Beck. It's always good, good Lord. Yeah, children's church, y'all can go. I thought they was just running because I come up very pretty. Thank you, Trey. Oh, mercy. I was fixing to say, it's always good to have people that encourage you in the mornings, and then they threw that in there, so it was good. No, it is. It's always good when you're a little bit anxious about singing a song or preaching or teaching Sunday school or whatever. Whatever you get anxious for sometimes coming to church. And you see people that say encouraging words to you or say loving things around you. And we're blessed with people like that. You know, every time I see Melissa, I want to smile. It don't matter what kind of day I've got. And same way as with Becky and some of the other people here at this church. So it's just good to have fellow believers that just make you feel good and relaxed when you come up here and ready to worship the Lord. And we're just happy to have everybody here with us today. Today, I know it, if you look in your bulletin, it says Nehemiah's Prayer, and that's what we'll be focusing on. But I titled today's message, How to Start Over. When you look at Nehemiah and you look at the things that he had to do to rebuild Jerusalem and rebuild the walls, I think he gives us a good blueprint on how to start over. And that can be starting over in your faith, your walk with the Lord. It could be starting over with something physically that you have to start over. Maybe you've lost a home. Maybe you've had some kind of a tragedy that kind of puts you in a position where you start over. Well, Nehemiah kind of gives us a picture of what we can do when we're faced with situations when it's time to start over. I have this week felt like I went back into the pioneer days. And I know this is going to sound silly, but we have had to put a roof on to get fixed from some of the hurricane damage that we've had. So we've had people stomping around and beating around on our roof for a week. And we've also had plumbing issues. So I've had water turned off for about half the week. And my poor kids are just miserable, you know. And on top of that, they unhooked the satellite dish so they could put the roof on. So we've been hard-pressed for entertainment to keep us from pulling each other's hair out here lately. But sometimes you got to do those fixer-uppers. You got to do those little projects to kind of start again and to kind of start fresh with things when you're building around the house or whatever. And those projects can be tough, but you got to persevere. You got to get through them. And so today, as we're looking at that, anytime you have those situations come up, you're going to have to come up with a few things that you're going to have to deal with right away. First of all, you got to know what the problem is. You got to realize what the problem is, what needs fixing, what kinds of things it's going to take to fix the problem. And then you got to have some goals and a willingness to go out there and get the project done and to fix what needs fixing. And any of those projects, you need a good leader. You need somebody that's going to organize things, somebody that's going to get things moving in the right directions and keep the project going even when you come into some things that really are not going real well for you or kind of give you a roadblock that you're going to have to kind of go through. And we're going to see that today with Nehemiah. So if you could, turn in your Bibles to Nehemiah chapter 1. I'm going to be looking at those first 11 verses there, and I'm going to be flipping back to a couple of other verses I think that go well with this passage too as we go to them. So first thing I want you to see this morning is that God shows us when and why it's time to start over. When and why it's time to start over. So let's look at verses 1 through 4 real quick. And now this is coming from Nehemiah himself. This is Nehemiah writing this. It says, the words of Nehemiah, son of Hakaliah, it says, in the month of Kislev, in the 20th year, while I was in the citadel of Susa, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that had survived the exile, and also about Jerusalem. They said to me, those who survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem has broke down and the gates have been burned with fire. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the Lord God of heaven. Let's pray real quick this morning. Lord, I just come to you this morning. I just pray that you just let me be your mouthpiece, Lord. Just use my imperfections for you and just hide me behind the cross. This is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So in these first couple verses, the first thing you need to know is kind of the context of what's going on. The Persians under Cyrus had taken over the Jews that were in exile during the Babylonian times. And it was Cyrus, if you'll recall, that actually let some of these Jews go back to Jerusalem and be with the Jews that were still that left behind during the exile. And so there was a remnant there. Well, the remnant that was there was living in Jerusalem where there were no walls. You know, people could come in and out. You had lots of different issues going on with people as far as interference from outsiders. But also you had lots of things going on with the people there in Jerusalem themselves. There are certain problems that God allows Nehemiah to know about right away. Talked about understanding when you've got a project what the problem is. Well, God informs Nehemiah through this, through his brother and through some of these other men, what exactly the problem is. It starts to burden him with that. It says there in those first couple verses that the survivors were in great trouble and they were in disgrace. Their walls were broken and the gates were burned. So there's four problems there that Nehemiah was going to have to address. There are two major issues, though. One was a mental issue, that these people were disgraced. They had anxiety. They had to worry about things like their safety, right? It was a big deal back then to live in a city during the biblical times with no walls, because you had the constant threat of outsiders coming in and threatening your safety. So you had to worry about that as a community, but you also had to worry about that also with your individual families. So there was a lot of mental anxiety that people were dealing with. I think about that in relation to right now. You know, we as individuals now more than ever probably in our history have dealt with more anxiety than probably ever before. And there's a vast assortment of reasons for that with social media and with all these other things that continually bombard us with things that just is mentally stressful. You know, there are some weeks where I would rather be physically stressed than I have been mentally stressed. I can get to a Friday some days as a teacher, and Miss Holly and some of our former teachers that have been in this room, and Doc will tell you, there's some Fridays when you get to Friday, I mean, by the time you get home, you just want to just flop down on the couch and just take a deep breath. Because it's been that mentally taxing on you and that mentally stressful. And you get that picture here with the people that have been left behind in Jerusalem, that they have been mentally taxed, that they have been mentally stressed from all the uncertainty and from the different things that were going on by having these walls that were broken down and having to worry about their safety. And also, with their problem, they had actual physical things that they were going to have to overcome. They had to do something about the wall. They had to do something to build that wall back and to get that project moving back in the right direction. And those things are tough, but sometimes those physical problems can be a little bit easier to overcome once we've got to the root of the mental issue, once we got to the root of what's been causing our genuine anxiety to begin with. So we knew we had a mental issue, we knew we had a physical one, and Nehemiah now is going to take his concern that you're going to see where it talks about he was mourning and he was praying and he was fasting, and he's going to turn that into something that's going to be determination. His first realization when he got what the problem was that he needed God. Was that he needed God to intervene and to help him get started with this big project that I'm sure in his head probably was not something initially he was wanting to take on. And we've all probably at some time in your life been given situations like that where you have something that weighs on your mind so much and stays on your mind so much and is such a concern to you that you finally say, you know what, I've got to do something about this. I've got to be the person that steps up and helps guide other people to help me get whatever kinds of a problem this is accomplished and done and project finished. And Nehemiah, I get the picture, was like that. You know, it occurs to me that sometimes God calls us to do things, sometimes when we don't realize we're really being called to do them. There are just certain things that God puts in front of us, whether he provides us with the things that we need to do to be that leader, whether he's provides us with the people that we need to do to be with us to solve that problem or to finish that project. But he provides those things. And Nehemiah was not a dummy. Nehemiah realized, hey, look, this is huge, and this is something that I'm going to need God's help with. And so the first thing he did was he prayed and he fasted. Now, I'll be the first to tell you, I probably do not fast like I need to fast. And if you've ever done that, if you've ever truly fasted and did it in an attitude of prayer where you focused on God for that day or that week or that 24 hours or whatever your time period that you decided to fast, if you've ever done that, you understand how important that can be. It's important enough that in Matthew, and I'm going to go there real quick. In Matthew, what you see there is he spends pretty much an entire chapter. If I can get there. He spends an entire chapter pretty much talking about prayer and fasting. And this is what it says in Matthew right here. If I can get this closer because I'm blind. It says, but when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think this will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So we pray all the time about things we need and things that we feel like we have to have in certain situations. That's great. Understand, God knows what you're doing. You're going to see here in some of this prayer that Nehemiah does, one of the things that happens is he's reminding stuff to God of what God has promised and what God has said. And he's not doing that because God needs reminding. He's good because he's doing that because he wants God to know. He understands exactly what God's instructions were. And he's reminding God, yes, we understand. We know what the issues are and what we need to do right here. So let's look at that real quick. It says, and I'm looking at verses 5 through 8 now. It says, then I said, Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we, Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction that you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the farthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place that I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. One of the things that's great about fasting and about prayer is it puts you in tune with what God wants from your life. I equate it to, and everything's technology now, so I'm going to equate it to this because I hear my kids scream about it all the time. I can't get on the internet because the Wi-Fi ain't working. Okay? Well, it's sort of like that, right? It's like getting on the internet with no Wi-Fi. If you're trying to do things in your life without God, and without being tuned in to God, that's exactly what it's like. You get that little spinning buffer that we all love that just sits there and spins and does nothing. Now, our lives can be a lot like that without God. And so sometimes you need to tune in, and you need to understand what it is that God wants from you, and fasting and prayer does that. And Nehemiah realized that right from the start, and so that's why he's praying to God. Now, the second thing I want you to understand today is that starting over requires God's guidance. Nehemiah realized that. If I'm gonna do a project, if I am going to start over with my life or with anything that I have going on, I'm going to need God, and I'm going to need His direction. I'm going to need Him to show me the path that I need to take in taking on this project and starting over. It's a real good guide to how we should pray to God in times like those. If you look at the first part right there, he honors God. That's the first thing he does. He's talking about how awesome God is and how important he is. And so he doesn't, you know, come right out and just say, you know, God, I'm going to treat you like Santa Claus, and I'm just going to ask for the things I need, and I'm not going to honor you, and I'm not going to acknowledge your presence in my life. No, he doesn't do that. He goes right away and he honors God with what he says there in his first part of his prayer. And then the second thing he does is he confesses the sinful ways, not just of the people of Israel as a whole, but he also confesses the sins with himself included. You know, that's another sign of a good leader. You know, good leaders don't say, well, you know, my team, if I'm a coach, they're not going to say, well, I had a great game plan, but my team was just lousy. You know, that doesn't hold a lot of good feelings with the group. And it's not true a lot of times. And so when you're a good leader, you're throwing yourself in there. And I'm sure I can tell you now, Nehemiah was a sinful human being like the rest of us. So I'm sure he had his faults and he had his things he had to confess to. And even though he was taking on this mighty task, he wasn't excluding himself from this confession time. And that confession is going to help you cleanse the soul. It's going to help you make good decisions. And so these good leaders don't exclude themselves from the accountability of what needs to be done and what has already been done. And so there's no room for excuses. When you're starting over, there's no room for excuses into why you can't do something or I don't have the ability to do this or do that. God doesn't want to hear the excuses. God's going to provide for you, and he wants you to be accountable for that. That's what he wants from his leaders, to be accountable to not only each other in the task that you have in front of you, but also to God, and that's very important. The third thing I think we can get from some of his prayer right there is that starting over means a willingness to change. You know, if you look at verse 8 and 9 right there, one of the things that you'll notice is that it sounds a lot like 2 Chronicles. It's almost like an echo of it. It's funny how these things work. My mama, the other day, we was having a discussion, and this was a verse that she actually brought up to me. And it says this, and you've all been familiar with it because lately it's been kind of a go-to verse for a lot of people with all the turmoil that we've had going on in society and in our world. It says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. You know, sometimes God's instructions are very, very simple, but we make them very, very difficult, don't we? I mean, how many times, and I see this a lot of times because I spend my life dealing with middle schoolers, right? And you can sometimes give middle schoolers very, very simple and specific instructions, and somehow they can manage to turn that into the most complex and just, you know, crazy, hard thing to have to follow that there's ever been in the history of the world. And adults can be a lot like that, too. You know, it's very plain, it's very simple what God wants us to do. He wants us to turn back to Him and rely on Him in order to fix the things that we have that are wrong. and fix those things that need fixing. And the problem is that we hear it, we understand it, but for most of us, we don't have the willingness. We don't have the fortitude or the willingness to be able to start that process and to start something that sometimes may be difficult. You know, starting over for some people may seem like it's the easiest thing in the world. But for a lot of us, it's very difficult. And the reason it's so difficult is because we have to completely change things, especially when it comes to our lives. That's why a lot of people know a lot about religion. They know a lot about what it is that the Bible says God wants from us, but they're not quite willing to do it because they're not ready to go in with both feet and make the change that's necessary to change their life. And so sometimes we can be our own worst enemy with that. But most people are just not willing to give certain things up. We're just not willing to give up certain pleasures that we have in our life. We feel like somehow the fun factor will be gone if we decide to make those changes and we let God take control. Sometimes we don't want to give up our time, right? Our time is too valuable. I hear that a lot when you try to get some people to come to church or you invite them to church. Well, I don't have enough time. I work hard Monday through Saturday. Sunday's my only day off, and I like to do this or that. And you get that a lot. Other times it may just be simply popularity. What are people going to think about me? How's this going to impact my reputation in the community if I change, if I do something different? And they're not willing to step out and to do the things that God needs them to do. All that stuff is what we call baggage. I've sat up here for a lot of Sundays and listened to Brother George talk about baggage. And there's a reason. It's because we all have it in some form or fashion. We all have that baggage that we carry with us. And some people think that because they have that baggage, they can't change. That people are going to look at them as a phony or a hypocrite or whatever. And so they're hesitant to make that change. But that's not what God wants. God wants us to give those things over to Him and leave the baggage at the door. The other thing that you need to understand right here, and this kind of goes on a little bit into chapter 2, which I will just touch on a couple of verses in chapter 2, is that starting over means a certain level of boldness. Now, it's interesting. I'm going to get us over there to chapter 2 right now. And there's a couple things to look at. First of all, Nehemiah was a cupbearer. Okay, so if you don't know what that is, that's like a taste tester for the king back in the day. So when they bring the wine out for the king to have his wine, the king ain't just going to grab be the first cup that he's drinking by himself. He got somebody that's going to be tasting it, make sure there ain't poison or ain't other stuff in there that might kill the king. They want that to be just right. So it is a position of trust. And this is going to be a thing that I believe this shows God's provision, because he put Nehemiah in a place where he could be trusted by the king. This was not just some run-of-the-mill job. This was something where the king was going to rely on him heavily and have to trust in him heavily. And so God is going to allow that trust to develop and allow him to show a pattern of behavior that when he gets out of that pattern, it's going to force the king to ask some questions about, you know, why are you acting different? What's wrong? What's bothering you? And that's not unusual. You have people all the time that you come in contact with that are happy, happy people. I mean, they put a smile on your face. You look at them at school or you look at them at your job and you say, I don't know how anybody can be that happy. They're walking around, they got a whistle, they got a smile, they always say something positive. And to be honest, for most of us, it's a little annoying, ain't it? You get there and you're like, I want somebody to be as grouchy as I am this morning. But you got some people that are like that. And those days, just ever so often, where you see somebody like that, and they come in and they've got a different look on their face, or they look a little, and they got a little anxiety, makes you ask, doesn't it? It makes you say, hey, something going on? Something bothering you this morning? Can I help you with something? So it gets us concerned, and that's exactly what happens right here with Nehemiah. It says, why does your face, and I'm in chapter 2 now in the second verse, it says, why does your face, this is the king talking, look so sad when you are not ill? This can be nothing but sadness of heart. I was very much afraid. Now, this is Nehemiah talking. I was very much afraid, but I said to the king, may the king live forever. Why should my face not look sad when the city where my ancestors are buried lies in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire? So he admits, I was afraid. I mean, you can all think of a time when you've been afraid. And it can be physical afraid that something's going on around you. Or it can be afraid that I got to step out here and do something that's going to make me uncomfortable. It's going to really put me out there in front of everybody. And I don't really want to do that. And Nehemiah was that way. He was afraid. I mean, he just came right out and said, I was afraid. But he didn't let that deter him from having boldness to come to the king with his problem. That he had this situation that was going on back in Jerusalem that was stressful, that was something that was taxing on his mind, and he wants to do something about it. And the king says, what is it that you want? And man, this was the point where a lot of other things could have happened here. He could have just clammed up. He could have just tried to hem-haw around what the actual problem was, but he didn't do that. He used that time, that opportunity that God presented to him, and he showed boldness in what it was that he wanted to present to the king. He says this. He says, then I prayed to God of heaven, and I answered the king. Now, I don't know if you've ever done this, but I've done it, where you had to say something, or you had to do something, and in the process of just it's fixing to come out of your mouth or it's fixing to be done in action, you spend that time for that first 5 or 10 seconds right there, you're making up your mind that you're gonna pray. That you're gonna say, God help me right now to say something that I need to say. The hardest thing in the world, and I know we've got some great Christian brothers and sisters in here that do the dental bus. Sometimes when you're in a situation with a person one-on-one with the dental bus and you're having to witness to them and to speak with them about the Lord, they ask you tough questions. I mean, you can ask anybody in here that's done it. They will ask you tough questions sometimes. And sometimes those answers are not easy. And when you get those answers, some of the best thing to do at that moment is to say that little prayer in your head, Lord, give me the words to say right now. Show me the direction that I need to go in right now. And that gives you that boldness that what I'm saying is coming from God. It's coming from God's heart. It's not coming from my mouth. It's coming from God's heart. And when you do that, you have that courage. You have that boldness to share the things that need to be shared. And Nehemiah was like that. He realized, hey, I'm in a situation here where it's going to take boldness. And it's going to take me speaking out. And so he did that. He takes that little time to pray. And then he tells the king this. He says, I answer the king, if it pleases the king and if your servant has found favor in your sight, let him send me to the city in Judah where my ancestors are buried so that I can rebuild it. So he just comes right out with the problem. This is what I need to do. Will you let me do it? And the king basically says, yeah, when can you be back? How about that? Just, yeah, you can do it, but when you going to come back? That's what I need to know. And this is great because now he's starting to feel his oats a little bit. He's starting to build with some of that confidence and some of that courage. And so he doesn't stop here. It says, I also said to him, if it pleases the king, may I have letters to the governor of Trans-Euphrates so that they will provide me safe conduct until I arrive in Judah. And may I have a letter to Asaph, keeper of the royal park, so he will give me timber to make beams for the gates of the citadel by the temple and the city wall for the residence I will occupy. And because the gracious hand of God was on me, the king granted my request. Ain't it interesting there that he throws that in? And because the gracious hand of God was on me, he granted my request. So he understands why things are starting to progress, why they're starting to move forward. And it's not because necessarily of anything he's done. It's because of what God is allowing to happen and what God wants to take place. All he's doing is just being a willing pawn for God. Just a willing person that's ready to step out and do what it is that God wants them to do and to start to make that change. In this case, it's a physical change with Jerusalem walls, But with us, it can be our daily lives. You know, there's a lot of turmoil that's going on that we know about, not only in our country, but all around the world. And that solution is not hard. It's just to have the fortitude and the willingness to go out there and do things that God wants us to do. The problem with that is when you do those things, you're going to have naysayers. And if you go on and you read, and I don't have time to go through the whole book of Nehemiah, but you know if you've read Nehemiah, once he starts building that wall and starts getting other people involved in this project, there's naysayers. There's going to be some people that are going to attack you. There's going to be some people that are going to tell you why you can't do it, why the project is big, why you don't have this, why you don't have that, why you just need to drop the whole thing. And that's when you've got to have the most courage and the most boldness and the most reliance on God when it comes to those issues with those projects in our lives. Many of us that are in this room at some point or another have gotten to the point in our lives where we have been broken, where we have been like the walls of Jerusalem. You know, there's been something that's going on with us personally, whether it's sin, whether it's some kind of tragedy that you've had to deal with in your life, and you basically are at the breaking point. You've gotten at the lowest point that you can possibly get at. And you have those mental burdens. You have those physical burdens, those emotional things that you're having a hard time getting over. You have the ability today to be the leader of that situation. You can be the Nehemiah of that situation today, and it just takes a few things. First of all, understand that to be a good leader means you not only lead from the front, but you also lead from the back. And I'm going to explain myself when I say that, because you can lead men from the front, but the best way to lead men from the front is to understand when it comes to leadership, you're behind the Lord. Whatever the Lord is wanting you to do is what you need to do. And when you understand that, and you can see yourself in that kind of hierarchy, then you're going to be a good leader, because you're going to understand very clearly what it is that God wants you to do in those situations, and you're going to be able to step out with a certain level of boldness to accomplish whatever mission it is and whatever change it is that you need to make in your life. And so my question to you today as I wrap this up is, why can't you be like Nehemiah today? Okay? God may be right now showing you that there's a when and a why to something that you need to change in your life today, or something that you need to address in your life today. I don't know what that is, but you do, sitting there. And some of you may have had something that's been gnawing at you for a few weeks or a month or two, and you just kind of been pushing it off. Well, my thought is that's probably God speaking to you and showing that, yeah, there is something that needs to change. There is a project. There is something that you need to do a little bit different. And why haven't you done it? Why haven't you been willing? Why haven't you showed that same boldness that Nehemiah did in what it is that you're doing for God? And so what you can do today when you leave here is work on getting tuned in with God. Listen, if you haven't fasted in a while, it's a great thing to do. It's a great thing to do. It clears your head. It gets you in tune with God. It makes you understand exactly what it is that God wants you to do, and gets you on that right track. I would encourage you to do that. I also encourage you to pray. Make sure you're taking time every day. Even if it's driving home in the evening and you just want to say a prayer to God and just thank Him for His greatness. Thank Him for the things that He gives you. And always be looking for those times and those things where you can do something bold for God. And then when you get those situations presented to you, have the fortitude to get through the roadblocks that are inevitably going to come up. Because they're going to come up. You're not going to get involved in a project where it's just going to be straight, smooth sailing. I've learned that this week. When you start dealing with an old house and you think you've got one project to do, and you get in the middle of that project and then you realize, uh-oh, I got three projects to do, right? And that happens. And those are little roadblocks and little hiccups. And you don't just get to that point and say, oh, we're just going to patch it up and just go on. You say, hey, we're going to fix it. We're going to push through this. We're going to do what we need to do to make this right. And God may be showing you that today. God may be showing you that there's some kind of roadblock there, that there's some kind of something that you need to overcome. If that's the case for you today, pray about it. Put that in God's hands. Understand where you are in the hierarchy of leadership. Let Him guide you in the direction that you need to go, and then have the boldness and the willingness to go there with Him, and you'll see something great and something powerful happen in your life, and you'll be able to give Him all the glory for those things. Let's bow in prayer this morning. Lord, I just thank you for your message, Lord. I just thank you for the example of Nehemiah and how we can use that in what it is that we have to change in our lives, Lord. And I don't know what the situation is. There may not be anybody sitting here today that needs to change something big right now, but there may be somebody watching this at home that is dealing with stuff and having a situation right now, Lord, that they need to change. And they need to come to you. I just pray that you just give them a boldness this morning and a willingness to just open up their heart to you and just be able to put that situation in your hand and then be faithful like Nehemiah into carrying out the tasks that you have for them in that time of change. We pray for the next few moments that we have, Lord, to just put our eyes on you. Put our hearts on you, and just we thank you for what you've already done today. And it's in Jesus' name, amen. Brother Ben's going to come lead us a invitation hymn. If you have anything on your mind you want to talk about or come share with me, I'll be glad to pray with you. If you're at home, yes. Absolutely. He's going to start us right now.
This is for everyone. I'm coming in boldness. I am, my heart is leaping. I don't have any tragedies. I don't have any hardships. I'm coming because God has sent me. God has wanted me to come here, to be here today, to show in boldness that everything that you just said is what we need to be doing. You have given us an introduction to what He wanted me to say today. And I want to be able to do what God said. And I want to show you all that you can do what God wants you to do and come in boldness. Because in faithfulness and in His love, because that's the only reason that we're here. And our desire should only be for what God wants us to do.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for sharing that this morning. I appreciate that.
I'm coming today in boldness. And I'm coming today to pray with every one of you, to pray with everyone that you know, because God is moving in such a fast pace right now, and we need to open our eyes and not just sit here and listen to words that He has spoken, but to feel it and to spread it and to share it. It doesn't matter if you share it with the person that you're sitting beside at a red light, or you're standing beside at the grocery store. You need to share this word. God is blessing us, and we are given the time right now. Tomorrow is too late. Yesterday was already too late. We are here today to be able to spread God's word and step out in boldness and to listen to how Nehemiah, he had to drink a cup to make sure someone else didn't die. We don't want to let someone else die because we are not bold enough to drink that cup and spread that word to him. So I want to pray with everyone, the Our Father, because Jesus was asked, how do we pray? And He said, this is the prayer. And would y'all mind praying with me this morning?
Absolutely.
Would y'all please stand and pray with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. Through your mercy, make us free from sin and protect us from all anxiety, where we live in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for sharing that this morning. Thank you. Ben, you want to lead us in our invitation hymn this morning?
Yes, sir. If you could, let's all open our eyes there.
Without him.
Without him, hymn 300.
Y'all all for coming out this morning. I always enjoy getting to share with y'all. I hope that had an impact on you for the coming week. And yeah, just show boldness and a willingness to do what it is that God wants us to do, and just show that love to everybody that you come in contact with. That's the best thing you can do during the week when we're out there in the community. So looking forward to seeing y'all back again next week. Keep in mind all the upcoming activities of the week ahead. And we'll look forward to seeing y'all back at the next point in time. Brother Ronnie, will you dismiss us in prayer this morning?
Our most gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you for the message that we received today, the Lord, and the testimony we've been here. May we be bold in our lives, the Lord, as we go out and we tell the world about your Son, Jesus Christ. But first, we must show the love in our hearts, the Lord, that you are in there. And with your love, we can tell people about your Son, Jesus Christ, dying on the cross, so we may have eternal life. Protect our pastor and his family, dear Lord, as they're away from us, dear Lord, and everybody else that is sick that cannot be here. Just touch them with a healing touch, dear Lord, that they can be back with us the next appointed time. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.